Dimension group, we take average of that, which we call P, 16P into 100 minus P divided by square of the difference which you want to detect. That is the formula for simple. So, what you put into the outcome is going to determine the sample size. And last time we discussed that a surrogate outcome generally yields a smaller sample size than a clinical outcome. Surrogate endpoints is generally gives you smaller sample size compared to clinical endpoint. And we gave several examples where CD4 count gives you much less sample size, but if you take mortality and AIDS, sample size required is more. If you take coronary artery stenosis, sample size is smaller compared to if you take death due to myocardial infarction. So that is why many people take surrogate out and do try, because it becomes more feasible, sample size is smaller, cost involved is less, resources required are less. But the downside of that, which we discussed last time, is that surrogate outcomes are not clinically meaningful or important for decision making. Often are subject to criticism because there may not be strong and consistent relationship between the surrogate outcome and the final clinical outcome. If clinical outcome doesn't change, then there is not much justification for adopting the intervention which you have proved as effective in your FMI study. So that is why to persuade clinical community to adopt an intervention or to get regulatory marketing approval from FDA of USA or DCGI of India, you need clinical outcomes. Except in high blood pressure and in cholesterol, FDA of USA has given approval on the basis of surrogate outcome. Cholesterol level in case of statins and BP level in case of antihypertensives. So you see, so many antihypertensives are there, all have not shown reduction of myocardial infarction, stroke, or death due to myocardial infarctions. Many have only shown reduction in blood pressure, and they have been accepted. There may be difference of opinion even among the experts whether just showing reduction in blood pressure is equal to showing reduction in stroke, myocardial infarction, or fatal stroke or fatal edema. This is why, if you are aware, time to time recommendations of Joint National Commission of USA on hypertension keep changing. Some experts, they may not give as much importance to surrogate outcome, therefore give advice or recommendations on the basis of clinical endpoint or clinical outcome. Others may accept this surrogate endpoint and give as much importance to results of the randomized trial as it is done on the basis of clinical outcome. So that is what we discussed the other. There is another way to make a trial more feasible, less costly, less time consuming, and that is by taking a combination of individual outcome points or end points as compared to single individual points. So, for example, if I ask you, if somebody is coming out with a treatment, like I told you, Baba Ramdev says he has got cure for hypertension. And the treatment which he thinks will cure hypertension is, anybody remembers?
Arjuna Prachal.
Vidya Muktavati. Suppose you want to test it. And I wish it was like that. And if it was tested properly, it would have been at least, even if it reduces blood pressure, it may also be a contribution. But if you want to test it, which outcomes you will take? Which outcomes, control of blood pressure, will prevent? If we control blood pressure, which outcomes we are trying to prevent?
Mean natural pressure.
Sorry?
Mean natural pressure.
No, that is the pressure we want to control. Why do we want to control pressure? So that?
Final outcome.
So, which outcome we are trying to prevent? You said cardiovascular. Which cardiovascular?
Acute coronary syndrome, sir. Ischemic or acute coronary syndrome, acute stroke, sir.
Acute coronary syndrome includes myocardial infarction, brother. Myocardial infarction included. Acute stroke.
Stroke.
What else?
Then aortic dissection, sir. That will also come under cardiovascular.
Cardiovascular may be many together.
And atherosclerotic, peripheral atherosclerotic.
Can there be sudden death due to cardiovascular disease?
Yes.
So sudden death, which is attributable to cardiovascular cause, will also be one of the outcomes, isn't it? So this is a very common combination of outcomes which people use.
Sir, cardiomyopathy.
Yes, it's possible. If it is long standing and LVH is there and left ventricular failure occurs, can be one of the endpoints which one might like to take. But it is not as dramatic as heart attack, right? So people sometimes have difficulty in diagnosing, so they take hospitalization due to heart failure. But patient may be in the community having shortness of breath or nocturnal dyspnea, but there is doesn't come to hospital. If it doesn't come to hospital, you don't know. So these are the various outcomes, and very commonly people take stroke, myocardial infarction, and cardiovascular death as a combined endpoint or composite endpoint. If you don't take, then what happens? Suppose you didn't take stroke. You are a cardiologist, so you only focused on myocardial infarction and death due to myocardial infarction. Then what will happen?
Incomplete trial. Study will stay as an incomplete informer.
So information available will be incomplete.
Yes.
Why do people want to know what happens to stroke? You are a cardiologist, you only want to know what happens in heart. Then what is the problem?
Bias will be there.
So one problem is that there may be number of strokes which you will not count. As a result, your incidence of outcome events in the control group will be less, will also be less in the intervention group, because you are not counting stroke.
Analysis.
And then one
problem will be that your sample size will go up because you are only counting maybe if it is equally frequent, then only 2/3 of the. On the other hand, as Dr. Bhattacharya said, that people want to know what happens to stroke. And not giving that information is incomplete information. So decision making by the clinician will be difficult. And how to interpret that trial will also be difficult. This is why people take composite outcomes. But certain precautions have to be taken. One example is, this is published already, LP sarcom versus amlodipine in diabetic nephropathy. And I'm just giving you conclusion of the trial. In comparison to amlodipine, LP sarcom reduced the combined endpoint of all-cause mortality, progression to end-stage renal disease, and doubling of serum creatinine. So they took a combined composite endpoint of mortality, end-stage renal disease, and doubling of serum creatinine. And they show there is relative risk reduction of 20% with 95% confidence interval, which ranges from 7.5% to 32%. Now, any question? We don't have nephrologist yesterday, Dr. Pratya is not there, no? Not there. So, there may not be, but as a general doctor also, you can ask questions. So, if you don't ask, I will ask you a question. Did LP sarcom reduce all cause mortality?
No.
Yes, it did. Okay, so Dr. Jeff Kass says it did. Any other viewpoint? Or any other question? So he said it did. Now I am giving you the data. This is the composite endpoint. Relative risk reduction of 20%, right? So, as you can see, the midpoint, which is also called point estimate, is very much aligned with 20%. And the confidence interval, 7.5% here to 32%, or somewhere here. So, this is the result which was shown in the trial. I'm going to give you so risk reduction, since we are talking of risk reduction. If it is positive, it is good or bad?
Good.
Good, because if it is positive, means risk positive reduction. If it is on this side, that means it is actually harmful, means it is increasing the risk rather than reducing it. And if it is crossing this line, that means we don't know whether it is reducing or increasing, right? So, doubling of serum creatinine, decreasing or increasing?
Decreasing.
Because it's good or bad?
Good.
Good. Good outcome. End stage renal disease. Increasing, increasing, or we don't know?
Not significant.
No, not significant.
Not significant. So it is crossing this line, and whenever there is crossing, then it becomes statistically non-significant. If the truth is here, it doesn't do anything. If it is towards the end, which is minus 0.5, probably it is harmful. But if it is on this side, it is very. This is the all-cause mortality. Right? Is it increasing, decreasing, or we don't know? We don't know. We don't know. If truth is that it is here, then it is very harmful. If it is here, it is useful. Point estimate is towards the wrong side, means don't know, truth may be here, so, but point estimate of the study data shows the trend that it may in fact be increasing. So that is the problem with the composite endpoint. We don't know what is happening to the individual endpoint. Therefore, there are some advantages of this and disadvantages of this. The whole reduction or relative risk reduction is dependent on what? In this case?
Sir, if there is all cause of mortality already has been taken, then what is the need of this composite endpoint?
So the one we have said, the one reason is that if you take multiple endpoints, then your sample size decreases. So you can do less costly, less time consuming study. And that is one of the main objectives. And sometimes one objective you said is also to inform adequately, right? So we need to tell everything about effects of the treatment. But in this case, as you can see, composite endpoint is being driven by
doubling of creatinine.
Everything is being pushed by doubling of creatinine, right? The question which you may ask the doctor, if somebody's creatinine doubles from 2, it becomes 4. Is it as bad as death?
No.
Which means clinical importance of doubling of creatinine is not same as mortality. Or even, is it same as end-stage renal disease? No. So, here the authors have combined endpoints which are not equally clinically important. Something which is as serious as mortality has been combined with much less serious doubling of serum creatinine. The whole result is being driven by the doubling of serum creatinine. So this is a good example of what are the advantages and disadvantages of taking composite endpoint.
Sir, here composite endpoint is a mixture of all cause mortality, end stage, and doubling.
Yes. Okay. Yes. If we had only doubling, then the relative risk reduction would have been 33%, because mortality is going in the reverse direction. That is why combining all these things is giving relative risk reduction of 20%. So, while this relative risk reduction is a little more, this is a little more, this is going the other way. So, it's overall coming to relative risk reduction of 20%.
सर, ये पेपर
तो पढ़े नहीं है, लेकिन सर क्या कॉज होगा सर डिस्कशन पार्ट में तो इसको समझाया होगा जरूर दैट व्हाट इज द कॉज ऑफ कंपोजिट एंडपॉइंट दैट इज गोइंग बैड. नो, दीज आर ऑब्जर्वेशंस एंड एज यू नो वी आर नॉट सेइंग दैट मोर्टैलिटी डेफिनेटली इंक्रीजेस. वी आर सेइंग दैट वी डोंट नो अबाउट मोर्टैलिटी एंड द पॉइंट एस्टिमेट इज गोइंग इन द रिवर्स But even the sample size, even the results of the study, we are not sure what happens to all-cause mortality. We are also not 95% sure about end-stage renal disease. Only thing we are sure is that doubling of serum creatinine goes down. Right? Explanation, biological explanation, they must have given, but may not have given also. If it is drug company funded trial, they will just keep quiet and only emphasize on this 20%. So this illustrates what precautions you have to take when you are taking composite endpoint. It's a good idea to take, because it will use a sample size, gives complete information. You want to know all the effects on stroke, effects on, like we discussed about hypertension. You want to know what happens to stroke. You may want to know what happens to fatal stroke, non-fatal stroke. What happens to fatal MI, what happens to non-fatal MI. What happens to unclassified sudden death, which is often cardiovascular. So those, you want to know everything. So complete information is one reason. Second reason is it reduces sample size. So,
sir, one thing, sir. From this previous graph, sir, can we say one thing that because here the all cause of mortality is going on the negative side, so and the out endpoints which were taken were doubling of creatinine and end stage renal disease. So other factors have become more dominant to give rise to increase all cause of mortality rather than doubling of serum creatinine and end stage renal disease. So those factors are more important than these two factors?
No, that is the explanation. How to explain this phenomenon. But one simple explanation may be they didn't have enough sample size to conclude about mortality. Okay. If they had enough sample size, maybe the whole thing will be here. Because truth may be anywhere, so you don't take necessarily the point estimate. Truth may be on this side. Yeah, the whole thing may be there was end point here and then confidence level on this side only. In which case this question will not arise. Right? But if it is the truth, suppose the truth, I should also say that maybe if you have enough sample size, the whole thing comes here. And the point estimate is here in the opposite direction. In which case, drug may be causing mortality due to other effects. Who knows? It may be causing arrhythmia and death. It may be causing some other metabolic disturbance and death. So, when you are doing a study, you don't know all the effects of the drug. So, you need to keep your mind open. That is why you need a trial, because all the effects of drug is not possible to know, even if you do hundreds of animal studies, because you may not be measuring something which is important. So a trial is necessary, which will give us the complete picture of at the end what happens. So that is basically, if they needed to do a larger study to conclude about more important things like end stage renal disease and all cause mortality, but they short circuited the whole thing by taking doubling of serum creatinine, which in their study favored so much that it led to statistically significant reduction in the composite endpoint, but without ensuring that end stage renal disease or all cause mortality is reduced. So this study cannot persuade clinicians to change their practice. Right? You need more studies before you start changing your practice. But at the same time, it is their duty to present all these three things separately. Otherwise, if they hide it, then you don't know what is going on. So, advantage of using composite endpoints is that it reduces sample size by increasing event rates. Therefore, you need less resources. A randomized trial, which is funded by the companies in US universities, for each patient, they pay thousands of dollars to the university. So you can imagine that if sample size is larger, they have to pay more money. And in contrast to this, in India, even if you don't ask them to pay, they don't fund even the basic necessity in Narendra Modi. Whereas in US and some other European countries, they spend huge amount. So if sample size is less, resource required is less. Second, or next is, you avoid arbitrary price of single outcome when many may be of equal importance. So, as we talked about high blood pressure, you may choose one, just for example, heart attack, and leave out important things like stroke or sudden cardiac death. So, this basically points to giving inadequate information. Another thing is, if you take stroke, myocardial infarction, and sudden cardiac death separately, then you will do 3 statistical tests, each one for finding out the value. If you do this, then you have to declare statistical significance, minimum you have to do is divide this 0.05 into 3 parts, and which means it will be 0.016 or something, right? So you will declare statistical significance only if the value is less than 0.016, which is a more stringent thing to do. So you don't have to, that is called adjustment for multiple comparison. You are comparing stroke between intervention and control arm. You are comparing MI between stroke and control arm. You are comparing sudden cardiac death between stroke, between control and intervention are 3 comparisons. If you do 3 comparisons, then p-value or significance has to be divided by 3, 0.05 divided by 3. That is avoided in this case, because you are doing only one statistical test. And also, sometimes, you know, when there are trials, like therapeutic stenting trial to prevent stroke, the intervention itself causes stroke. As you know, when you are removing therapeutic plus, some of it will be detached, going past stroke. There is stroke due to treatment, and the stroke if you don't treat. If you want to know net, whether actually overall what is happening to stroke rate, then you have to combine both the outcomes, which is perioperative stroke and late stroke. In case of cardiac disease, there can be death due to the drug, like enteritis by the drug, enteritis. And that was causing arrhythmia and death, but it was also meant to, I think, be positive inotropic effect, and therefore it was supposed to reduce mortality also. So the drug, some adverse effect of the drug may cause death, but the drug by positive or beneficial effect may reduce death. Overall, what is happening to the death? You will come to know if you take combined in point of both. Or if you want to know overall what is happening to the cardiovascular endpoints, the net effect will be visible if you take composite endpoint. Hence, second, of course, last thing is, if you have less time consuming trial, then effective treatment will be available earlier than it is if you have a long term trial. But it has many disadvantages. Disadvantages, as we have seen. One is that components, in our example, doubling of serum creatinine in stage renal disease and mortality, they may be there may be unreasonable combination, in which case sometimes they take an outcome and after the study has been done, they change rather than suppose you took tripling of serum creatinine. You may change at the end of the study and say, no, we will take doubling because that is what is coming to give you significance. Mm. So that possibility is there. Second thing is, as we have said, improvement can be driven by less important outcome, doubling of serum creatinine. And it would not support a claim based on the whole composite endpoint. Because as we have seen, we can't say that mortality or end-stage renal disease is increased. And another point which our example illustrated was, effects observed on separate components of a composite endpoint may not be in the same direction. Mortality is going in the reverse direction. In this case, it would be difficult to explain the overall effect observed on the composite endpoint, which we were trying to explain, right? Not easy question. Inclusion of unresponsive components may reduce the effect of the composite outcome. So you are trying to maximize and the sensitivity of the study and reduce the sample size. It may go the other way. If you have some composite, some endpoints which are not responding to the treatment, so you have to keep that in mind. So, for example, if you were doing a COVID trial and you took, let's say, thrombotic phenomena and respiratory phenomena as a combined endpoint, but your drug is having effect only on thrombotic phenomena, then it will not have effect on respiratory phenomena and unnecessarily you will jeopardize yourself. Similarly, sometimes there can be bias in the sense, people say, discharge from hospital, sometimes that is like an endpoint. And you know, particularly if it is not a blinded study, discharge is a decision made by the doctor who may try to, maybe he is biased in favor of an intervention, he will try to show that actually, discharge is facilitated, and if he is not blinded, then intervention arm he will discharge quickly. Example will be, suppose you are doing a trial of laparoscopic cholecystectomy and where total distance. The one who is doing laparoscopy is biased in favor of laparoscopy. And he wants to show that hospital stay is diminished. The best way to show is that you discharge from second day, third day, right? Your prophecy will be fulfilled. So there can be sometimes combination of endpoints, some are influenced by bias. But if somebody took, for example, let's say post-operative infection, it cannot be, and it was judged by a third party, it cannot be influenced. So sometimes people combine something which they can change with something which they cannot change. The whole thing is driven by something which they can change. That is not permissible. And you already talked about lack of relevance of some components. So some components may be clinically less important. So not all patients may attach similar importance to each component. And there can be many examples. I told you that alpha error must be adjusted, which we discussed very briefly. So, good composite endpoints have three criteria. One, it should be of similar clinical importance. Can't be doubling of serum creatinine and mortality, right? But if you take fetal stroke, myocardial infarction, both are important. Even severe stroke may be as bad as death. So you can combine severe strokes, severe MIs, fatal MI, fatal stroke, and undiagnosed sudden cardiac death also in one composite endpoint. I will give you a chance. They should be of similar frequency. It is not easy to predict this, but roughly the same frequency. Otherwise, there will be obviously risk of one going in the other direction. And there should be similar effects, means direction of effects should be similar. Otherwise, as I said, you combine respiratory problem and thrombotic problem, you are giving something which works to prevent thrombosis. How can it affect respiratory problem? So effects, unless they are in the same direction, you should not combine those endpoints. So what does FDA of USA say about this? FDA of USA says things which we have discussed. But just to make sure you know that regulatory agencies also have some viewpoint on this. So composite endpoint is a single measure of effect based on a combination of individual endpoints. What is its importance? It's useful for drugs that can benefit patients in several ways, or if component events are infrequent. So if events are there to combine, then you make it more feasible to do this. So what are the examples? Cardiovascular death or hospitalization for heart failure. We were talking about that. They say you can combine this. Major adverse cardiovascular events. We talked about this. Cardiovascular death, non-fatal MI, and non-fatal stroke. So stroke, MI, cardiovascular death. You can combine. Very commonly used combined endpoint. You may also take clinical worsening, which may include decline in functioning, worsening of symptoms, addition of the new medication for control of symptoms, hospitalization due to disease, or death. So all unfavorable outcome in one. Make sure your intervention works in all of them. Or health-related quality of life instruments are also actually combined or composite endpoints. If you want to do survival analysis like Kaplan-Meier curve, then it has to be analyzed at time to first event. So patient, the moment he gets a stroke, endpoint is this. And somebody doesn't get a stroke, but he gets MI, endpoint is this. So time to first event is analyzed. Sometimes you may get number of events like they have done in the research. What are the things which you should consider? This is from FDA of USA. Each component should itself be clinically meaningful. So that is one. Ideally, each component would be approximately equally meaningful. So like doubling of serum creatinine and this death should be should not be combined, because they are not equally clinically meaningful. And success should not be concluded if driven by a less meaningful component. This is what those authors did. If there is evidence of therapeutic disadvantage on a more meaningful component. So death was going in another direction, doubling of serum creatinine, which is less meaningful component, that shows success and they concluded success. The composite should not include individual components for which treatment effect is not expected. We talked about respiratory and thrombotic phenomena. Combined, you may not be able to combine this because effects are not expected on one or the other. On the other hand, you may say respiratory phenomena is also because of thrombosis, in which case you may combine also. So there should be good logic to combine. And of course, it complicates communication of the established benefit of the drug. There may often be inadequate evidence to establish a treatment effect on any of the components individually. So, if a trial wins on major adverse cardiac events, can you conclude that drug improves survival? Obviously, you can't, because unless mortality is also separately statistically significant. So there are problems with it, but often people use it. You can use it. There is no problem. So to summarize, I think this last time's lecture and this one. One is you should always emphasize on clinically meaningful endpoints. This is contrary to what doctors think. Doctors think if we take HbA1c, that is more important than taking diabetic nephropathy or diabetic neuropathy or diabetic retinopathy. But that is not the case. Actually, the clinically meaningful endpoints are more important. Of course, more difficult also to study. But for many things, unless clinical endpoints change, drug is not approved. In phase 1 or 2 studies, you can take surrogate endpoints. And in fact, it should be preferred because you are not going to spend huge amount of money on a study which or an intervention which doesn't pass phase 1 and phase 2. And composite endpoints, as I told you, they confer greater power, but always keep in mind their relative importance and their amenability to effects of the information. That's all.
Phase 1 or 2 wo jo bole hai usme lekin surrogate endpoint may be preferred.
Yes. I will give you an example.
Phase 1 and 2.
Phase 1 and 2, yes. Well, for example, I think I have told you when stem cell hype was coming, and whether you know or not, our then President Dr. APJ Abdul Kalam was very keen that India should do studies on stem cells. So every department was asked to do, Department of Biotechnology was also advised to do it. So he called us, he called cardiologists also, and the third group of peripheral arterial disease surgeons. So, three groups were assigned to do this trial. Question was, what phase of trial we do? Do we
take phase 1, phase 2? It was combined. Phase 1 was combined with the phase 1 was, you can say, very small, 10 patients or so. Phase 2 study was randomized.
So, how big should be the trial?
You go by usual clinical outcomes, it will be 500-600 patients. And in fact, cardiologists did a trial with 250 patients. We use surrogate outcome, and we had imaging outcome, we had clinical outcome, but our sample size was 120, right? Still, 120, I asked DB team, 5 centers, how much did it cost to you? It was almost, what they tell me, it was 6 crores. This center got about 1 crore, so must be, that includes, they had a, monitoring agency going around, contract research organization. Which center monitoring it, they had a separate data monitoring team. So it cost about 6 crores. If you straight away want to do with clinical endpoint, it will cost 30 crores. So before you launch a big study, you must show some effects. So after our phase 2 study was complete, there was no reason to do phase 2. And it was not only my opinion. One, I told you that one stroke expert came from Australia and I showed him, this is the data. What do you say about phase 3? He said, no point for phase 3, sir. On the other hand, when we sent the paper to New England Journal of Medicine, their only comment was that it should have been a bigger study, it's a small study. Right? But bigger study would have been waste of resources.
So phase two study you do with smaller sample size to show some benefit, a potential benefit, you have to take a survey. So both criteria you show that there is some potential benefit, at the same time you don't waste resources. So many of you who want to do, I will come to next, what randomized trials you can do, right? I have covered most of the elements which are necessary to know in designing a trial. But each, you may be thinking what trial I can do. Each department, if you sit down, you will have a list of 20 trials which you can do. And randomized trial is something sought after by all the journals. Because as you know, this is the highest level of evidence. And you may be wondering, I must have something like stem cell. No, it's not necessary. Even randomized trial people are doing of SMS, you know that. Many papers are there. Giving SMS reminder to the patient, does it increase compliance? This is a randomized trial. Even ICMR has funded a big randomized trial just from SMS reminder. Big I say because it is all over the country, so different languages have to be covered. Message has to be in different languages. It should be proper translations. It is complex. But if you want to do it in one center, you can simplify it. Even giving simple advice, people have done randomized trial. You know, in smoking cessation, there are so many randomized trials. I think Dr. Anand Singh presented some data and gave him two ideas about randomized trials. He said, not that he. I went for my one checkup and I was just listening to their discussion. So, I think Dr. Opekas was also checking, right? So, he said, correct me if I'm wrong, but I do not remember exactly what you said. That you don't give one saline gargle, you say only plain tap water or normal temperature gargle, something like that. No, hypertonic and isotonic, yes. I don't take hypertonic, I don't like hypertonic. And Dr. Anand Singh likes, he likes isotonic, he likes hypertonic. This is a question about randomized. What is the problem in this? And I can guarantee you this will be, of course, not only published in a very respectable journal, it will change the practice. So we don't think of simple things.
Abhi chapa hai sir, 10 sample size ka ek paper abhi chapa hai about the gargling from in COVID patient, whether it is beta gargling or simple with salt gargling. Only sample size was only 10.
So if that is the sample size which is required, it is
chlorhexidine, betadine, one saline.
Similarly, in gynecology, gynecology is a component. Dr. Kiran is there. And yes. Anybody else? No. So, initially in Oxford, they started doing simple trial. Episiotomy. I have done episiotomy as intern. It was a routine for primary graviter to do episiotomy. This is what we got taught, we have done it. They did a randomized trial, episiotomy and primary graviter, 50-50. I don't know how big is the trial, you can read and see. And it showed no difference. They stopped episiotomy, right? When I imagine this, you can't imagine how much we actually caused pain and suffering to the patients by following something like episiotomy routinely on all primary gravita. Usually these newcomers, interns will be there, right? I was posted in Southern Hospital here in Nanchi. Even without knowing how to cut stitches, I have done episiotomy.
And without local anesthesia.
That's right. That was without local anesthesia. Okay, yes. So,
don't you think this randomized trial which stop epistemology is a big contribution? It is a big contribution because those who have suffered through this, seen people suffer, they know how important it is just to know that epistemology is not. So simple things can be subjected to randomized trial. But you have to think about it and read literature. Already a lot of literature except says this is not known, this is not known, this is important, but no randomized trial available and so on. So if you plan it, you can do it, and your residents can do thesis. So for example, just to give you an idea, we get a lot of patients of stroke with diabetes. Now nobody knows whether this basal bolus insulin regime is better than sliding scale. Endocrinologists have done some studies in their own department or in ICU and say that basal bolus is better than sliding scale. It is not easy because stroke patients, they don't eat. We don't know whether they will eat or not eat. So we are very scared that basal bolus will give one time and we don't know whether they are going to eat and vomit or not. So it may cause hypoglycemia. We said, why don't you do a randomized trial? So she did a randomized trial between two regimes of insulin and showed same degree of control. We took certain criteria for control, but more hypoglycemia and basal bolus. So I think in stroke field, this is either second or maybe in the first. Similarly, another person, another resident of mine, he was doing a randomized trial of the same thing, sending SMS reminder to people to do INR if they are on anticoagulant. You know, it is very important. Those who are on anticoagulant, you say every month you do INR. Who does it? Nobody does it, right? They take advice in AIMS, all patients go to Bihar or something, there is no facility for INR, nobody is doing it. Right? So, we said you, yes, please, go ahead. So, give this thing, reminder. And he wanted to check whether there is more frequent monitoring, but compliance, INR is within control limits and so on. So, you can do, your residents can do right randomized. So you think about it, and next time we will discuss ideas about randomized trial, right? Or we should, if there is any other topic in mind, please come.
Sir, one talk on qualitative research. Sir, because then
qualitative research is difficult, but it is more difficult than
qualitative. That is it. काफी इंटरेस्ट है सर लोग करने का
इनको हाउ मेनी पीपल आर इंटरेस्टेड इन क्वालिटेटिव रिसर्च सो मे बी 50% लेस देन
दैट सर उसको स्टार्ट लर्निंग कर ले वी आर डिसाइडिंग हियर इन ड्रीम ऑफ कैंपस ड्रीम्स सो द बेसिक थिंग अ लॉट ऑफ थिंग्स आर गोइंग ऑन हियर बिकॉज़ आई टॉक टू सो मेनी पर्सन द बेसिक थिंग्स की स्टडी सिलेक्शन कैसे करेंगे जो बेस तो सर मजबूत होगा तब तो लड़ाई लड़ेंगे तो फर्स्ट थिंग दैट स्टडी सिलेक्शन हाउ यू विल कैलकुलेट द सैंपल साइज फ्रॉम प्रीवियस स्टडी हाउ यू विल राइट द इंट्रोडक्शन मटेरियल एंड मेथड रिजल्ट पोर्शन बिकॉज थीसिस इज टोटली डिफरेंट फ्रॉम अ बीइंग अ मैन्युस्क्रिप्ट
सो नो सिंस रेजिडेंट्स हैव गॉट टू डू थीसिस they better do a study which can be published, right?
Because nowadays, what is the most important thing that every journal wants CTRI registration, clinical trial registration.
Yes.
If still, agar sabke paas sir do paper ho jayega, sab free jump ke larne ke liye phir tayar ho jayenge. The person who wants to do that.
In next phase when COVID is under control, we will have junior residents also separate system, right?
Okay.
So then they will start coming up with their own ideas.
As per MCI, DOAJ, SCOPUS, PubMed Central, Indian Citation Index is required for the promotion. Everyone found that, even me also. So, what the important thing is that at least first every person should start from basic thing.
So you already started even without doing a study, doing a systematic review itself is a publication, na?
Yeah.
So you think it will not be counted? It will be counted.
Definitely, I am not thinking about myself. I have said 22 original article paper, so I don't have problem.
So others will also do it. They are doing it. I think one publication is there from neonatology also.
My judgment.
So people are already doing now. You will find that they will start doing it without even necessarily taking our help. That is what my goal is. Every department should be doing it without any
other help. Sir, अभी 0 से 20 तक तो पहुँचा है.
वही ना.
धीरे-धीरे बढ़ेगा सर.
So next time we will either take consort. Consort is not something we have covered now. How to be more randomized. So we will take consort, some part of it to discuss, right?
Yes.